It's been 6 months since the horrific massacre in Khartoum during the Sudanese revolution. On June 3rd, over 120 people were brutally massacred while they were taking part in a sit-in in front of the army headquarters in the city. All these months later, the families of the victims have not received justice. In this episode of Around the World in 8 Minutes, we'll be looking at the continuing struggle of the Sudanese people and many more stories of people's movements and struggles across the world. Stay tuned. The massacre in Khartoum came at a vital moment. After months of protest, Sudan's people had forced their president Omar al-Bashir to resign in April. A military junta took over and the people were furious. They wanted a civilian government and began a sit-in in front of the army headquarters in Khartoum. On June 3rd, the Rapid Support Forces, a militia not formally associated with the army, was unleashed on the protesters. They shot innocent civilians, chased them out of the site, and even invaded hospitals where the injured were being treated. In the following days, bodies with injuries were recovered from the Nile. Rocks had been tied to the bodies to make sure they drowned. Many women, young boys and girls were raped. This brutal offensive set the protests back briefly. But the Sudanese people fought back, and due to their consistent agitations, the junta was forced to agree to a transitional government with civilian participation. Today, Sudan's Prime Minister and most of its ministers are appointees of the Declaration of Freedom and Change Forces, a civilian body representing the protesters. However, the people of Sudan have not forgotten the massacre of June 3rd. On December 3rd, exactly 6 months later, thousands took to the streets across the country to demand justice and the prosecution of those who ordered the killings. In Khartoum, the protests began at the home of one of the victims and a march was carried out to the site of the massacre. People held up photos of those who had died. Resistance committees were organized at a neighborhood level with the backing of the Sudanese Communist Party and the Sudanese Professionals Association, which had spearheaded the Sudanese revolution. An investigative team has been set up to probe the massacre, but that is not enough. The Sovereignty Council, Sudan's top governing body, has as its members General Abdel Fattah al-Burhan and General Mohamed Hamdan Dagalo. Burhan was the head of the military junta when the massacre took place, and Dagalo is the head of the Rapid Support Forces. However, these generals have immunity as they belong to the Sovereignty Council. Only a legislative council can remove this immunity. But this council has not been yet formed, although the deadline was November 20th. For Sudan's people, the revolution has just begun. In the coming months, they will have to keep fighting to ensure that their victories are protected and that the scope of the revolution expands and true justice is delivered. We next go to India, where thousands of construction workers gathered in New Delhi to protest the government's failure to distribute millions of rupees in cess, as well as the non-provision of welfare measures. The march takes place even as the far-right Narendra Modi government is drastically overhauling labour laws in India. The government is introducing 4 labour codes which will drastically reduce the scope for unionisation and increase casualisation of labour. Basically, in India, your work as an employee will be completely at the mercy of your employer. The construction workers' protest is part of an all-India movement against these measures. Let's see what some of the protesters had to say.
There are funds worth rupees 420 billion with the labor board in our country. Different states have different amounts with them. For example, the labor board in Haryana has rupees 30 billion and Delhi has rupees 27 billion. But the government wants to hand this over to the capitalists. They want to reduce the 44 central laws that existed to protect workers' rights to 4 code bills. Through this, they want to end the 8-hour workday and the minimum wage laws. All the workers' rights, which were enforced in 1996 after a long struggle, the BJP government wants to get rid of all those rights. We have collected around 10 billion signatures and we are going to submit our memorandum to the Speaker of the Lok Sabha. We are also going to submit our demands to the parliamentarians. The CPM MPs will also raise our issues inside parliament and we will continue to raise our voice outside. Till our demands are met, we will continue our struggle in different states across the country. We are also holding a nationwide general strike on January 8th with these demands.
We now move on to a major victory by young healthcare professionals in Buenos Aires in Argentina. The city government on December 5th revoked a law passed on November 28th that declared medical residents and concurrents as only trainees. This followed a massive march by the medicos on December 4th. The law was passed without consulting the residents and concurrents and would have led to a substantial weakening of their working conditions. The maximum work time for residents and concurrents was set to 64 hours, which would have caused a great deal of fatigue and would have endangered patients as well. It also reduced maternity and paternity leaves, as well as stress leave. Most significantly, it excluded these medicos from participating in any process of collective bargaining. The government was effectively saying that young healthcare professionals were not workers. In response, a huge movement was launched. The residents and concurrents marched on a number of days to the health ministry. Finally, after December 4th's massive mobilization, the government was forced to give in and withdrew the law. This marks yet another victory for the people against the right-wing agenda that has been continuously pushed by the government and party of Mauricio Macri. Macri, the current president, was recently defeated in the elections and will soon leave office, a true triumph for the people of Argentina and the region. Finally, we leave you with glimpses of another major demonstration in India, organized by the leftist organization Democratic Youth Federation of India. The DYFI organized this huge march against the privatization of Bharat Petroleum Chemicals Limited, or BPCL, a public sector undertaking. This company is a giant in the petroleum sector in India, but the Narendra Modi government has been extremely keen to sell its stake in the company. The government has been claiming that there is a cash crunch, but we need to remember that this is the same Modi who has been giving huge tax write-offs to corporates. Incidentally, one of the biggest competitors of BPCL is owned by India's richest man, Mukesh Ambani. So we do know at least one possible beneficiary if BPCL is sold. For the young leftists in India though, this move is a danger at multiple levels, including the possibility of unemployment and the very future of the economy itself. And they have mobilized in huge numbers over this. Here are some scenes from the rally. That's all we have in this episode of Around the World in 8 Minutes. To know more about these stories, visit our website peoplesdispatch.org and follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. Thanks for watching.